Welcome to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with co-host Chase Palmieri. On today's program, The Watchdogs Didn't Bark, the CIA, NSA, and the Crimes of the War on Terror. We're joined by authors of this book, John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski. Their book had a foreword by the great David Talbot, and we'll be talking about this book for the hour on today's Project Censored Show. Stay with us.
Political ties, habitual eyes, alibis, disguise, another guise of democracy, politics, and the apocalypse, got the skies looking ominous.
Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with co-host Chase Palmieri. On today's program, for the hour, we are going to be talking about a book that was released about a year ago on Skyhorse Hot Books, and those of you who have listened to the Project Censored Show for some time know that David Talbot was one of the forces behind the Hot Books for Skyhorse in New York. John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski are with us today. They are the authors of The Watchdogs Didn't Bark, The CIA, NSA, and The Crimes of the War on Terror. Ray Nowosielski is a documentary filmmaker and writer who has reported for Salon and Truthout, and he's contributed to investigations by The Daily Beast and Gawker. Ray's produced documentaries with several Academy Award-winning directors and for Discovery, History Channel, Investigation Discovery, Netflix, and Vice on HBO's Emmy-nominated Season 3. The Intercept co-founder Glenn Greenwald tweeted in 2014 regarding Nowosielski's reporting about the CIA, quote, "Your work was fantastic and brave at that." John Duffy is a writer and activist. He wrote and produced the critically acclaimed documentary Press for Truth and the investigative true crime podcast Who is Rich Blee? Duffy has worked extensively in the environmental movement to fight tar sand extraction, fracking, and logging on public lands. His anonymous essays critiquing the contradictions of big systems and their fallout on ecology and society appear regularly in a variety of media. He currently lives in a quiet cabin in the Midwest with his family. John Duffy, Ray Nowosielski, thank you so much for joining us today on the Project Censored Show.
Well, thank you for having me.
It's an honor to be on.
You know, I still show Press for Truth in my critical reasoning and historiography course every semester. So I've certainly followed your work for some time. And it's really great to see that you're both still very active and doing important work. Your book that came out roughly a year ago at Skyhorse, The Watchdogs Didn't Bark, David Talbot, founder of Salon and the Hot Book Series, said Watchdogs could be the most important book published so far in the Hot Book Series. And we've had several Hot Books guests on the Project Censored Show, and saying that is quite something because there are some stellar authors in the Hot Book Series. So Ray and John, kudos to you for being part of that fantastic, important series. CIA whistleblower John Kuriakow, he went to prison for nearly 3 years for outing the CIA's torture program while no one in the CIA went to prison for torturing. Kuriakow said of Watchdogs, "The authors lay bare an intelligence failure of historic proportions." And Alex Gibney, co-creator of Hulu's The Looming Tower, said, "Stories of characters in the dark corners of the bureaucracies, where the secrets are kept. Duffy and Nowosielski name names and hold people to account. If only our government had the courage to do the same." Well, Ray and John, again, welcome to the program. Congratulations on your book, The Watchdogs Didn't Bark. Let's just start, given that you two have very interesting histories, how did this project happen for the both of you? Ray?
We met going to Columbia College in Chicago, and as you mentioned, we did the film Press for Truth, this little documentary that was made for just over $100,000. We followed the story of the group of 9/11 widows who had fought for the commission and felt that the government was just refusing to hold people accountable for obvious failures and possibly corruption and other cans of worms that had been opened by looking a little bit closer at the 9/11 attacks. So we wanted to be done with that subject and move on to other things. We've got a lot of diverse interests and had planned to do so, but we stumbled on the trail of this possible withholding by CIA before 9/11 regarding two of the lead 9/11 hijackers. And the more you looked at it, the more there seemed to be some meat on the bone. We started talking with people at CIA, at FBI, people who had worked in the White House, and we were shocked when we would call up a former counterterror person and they would tell us, oh no, this is the story. Like, you're on the right track, and we're shocked that no one's covered it. Bottom line is, we ran into a little trouble in 2011 when we tried to release the interviews we'd gotten so far up to that point. We were going to do it what at the time was this novel concept of a true crime investigative podcast. And we got threatened, actually, by the CIA public affairs person with potential prosecution if we proceeded with the names of two human rights abusers that we had uncovered. So we get this lead that David Talbot is looking for, like, up-and-coming, outside-the-box, interesting authors for the Skyhorse Hot Books label.
Let's dive into the content on this. Project Censored is no stranger to dealing with 9/11 issues or 9/11 controversies. We do, however, like the both of you, do have standards for evidence and factual reporting. We don't like to go down speculative paths and make wild claims that serve as long-term distractions. And one of the things that really struck me about the significance of your book is that Peter Phillips and I, we've long tried to keep the 9/11 research that we cover very journalistic, fact-based, transparently sourced. And I think The Watchdogs Didn't Bark is really in that vein. And that's why I'm happy to have you both on the show. So Richard Clark, the former counterterror advisor to Presidents Clinton and Bush, you had a pretty interesting encounter with him.
That has been written up as like our big get, and it probably was. And how we got it, both of us still wonder at that. But it was simply by asking him. And when people think like these two guys who are pretty much unknown, you know, myself and Ray, the fact that we got Richard Clark to talk to us about this so candidly, when they wonder at how we were able to make that happen, one of our stock answers is that we wanted to talk to him about something he wanted to talk about. And we knew what he wanted to talk about because he had written about it in his second book. His second book wasn't the bestseller that his first book, Against All Enemies, was. And in this second book, it was called Your Government Failed You. And in that book, he had a chapter or a portion of a chapter where he basically was venting about the fact that he had learned that upwards of 50 officers at the CIA had been privy to the visa information regarding Khalid al-Midar, and that no one there had bothered to tell him or his staff. And he goes into a bit of the detail there. That was one of the things that launched our interest. He wrote this book, and apparently no one came a-calling. When we sent an email to him, he was in the private sector by that time, working for a cybersecurity firm he had going. When we sent him an email saying, hey, we want to talk about this, he responded positively and said, come on up. So we took a trip out to D.C. and met him at his office and had a great conversation with him. And the video of that, an edited video of that, I should say, which is about roughly 10 minutes long, is available on the internet. People can watch it to get the gist of what he told us. But it was just really damning information. And the interesting thing is, we thought we would have to be very subtle and coy. We thought that he would hem and haw a bit and that he wouldn't lay any real heavy blame anywhere. But he actually came out very hard charging, and he was very direct in his accusations. He basically claimed that he thought there was a high-level operation within the CIA that must have had the approval of the then-director, George Tenet, to hide these two individuals, Khalid al-Midar and Nawaf al-Hazmi, who would go on to be hijackers, to hide them while they were in the United States. They arrived 18 months before the attacks, and he believed that the likely motivation for that high-level operation was ostensibly for the CIA then to have access to these al-Qaeda figures to try to turn them, flip them, or at least have proxy get close to them to get them reporting information for them so they could get so-called ears in al-Qaeda.
Ray, do you want to add to that?
There's a few details, like the CIA since its inception, which it's not as old as a lot of people might think. It first showed up in 1947, so we did without it before, just putting that out there. But the CIA, from its beginnings, was barred from operating domestically. They're supposed to be collecting information on foreign assets, foreign governments, not on the people of the United States or anything within the boundaries here. So that was supposed to be the FBI. Normally what would happen is if they were surveilling somebody overseas, let's say it's Al-Qaeda, and they arrive in the U.S., as these two gentlemen did in January of 2000, the proper protocol, what the law says, is that they were to call up John O'Neill over at the New York FBI and let him handle it the way he saw fit from there. But the further theory by Clark, there was a very well-known and terrible, truly laughably god-awful relationship between CIA counterterror and FBI counterterror. And the belief was that the CIA ALEC station, the Al-Qaeda office, desperately wanted and needed a win at the tail end of the Clinton era on the terrorism issue, and that they chose to break the law. And because they chose to do that, it made it impossible, once they got in over their heads with the 9/11 plot appearing to be moving forward, it made it very difficult for them to come clean to the FBI. And that's sort of like the working theory. It's not that anyone wanted this to happen. It's that people were initially trying to do their jobs, but at some point they were just in too deep. And if they'd have come clean, for instance, these men were connected to an attack called the USS Cole that killed 17 servicemen in Yemen in October of 2000. So by that point, they'd already been hiding these guys for about 6 months, surveilling them, trying to flip them. So how do you come clean at that point and say, hey, by the way, two guys connected to the Cole attack, they're here. We've been watching them. Go easy on us. So that's the working theory. And I don't know, once Clark laid it out, it made a lot of sense to us. And it seemed to open the door thereafter where we were able to talk with a number of people in the government in counterterror, where it's sort of like a light bulb went off for them. And they were like, I've kind of believed something like this for a long time because it's the only thing that explains the fact.
And so during this interview, Richard Clark highlights that the CIA did not hand off this information to the FBI. And can you just go a little bit deeper into maybe what his speculations were as to why that handoff didn't occur?
It can get a little into the weeds, which is why we wrote the book. But the gist is that they had been operating domestically inside the United States, apparently keeping tabs, possibly through their allies in Saudi intelligence, to these two future hijackers in San Diego. And so essentially they were breaking the law, particularly once the USS Cole attack happened about 6 months after the guys entered. They, as Lawrence Wright, the Pulitzer Prize winner, put it to us, he's always believed that those people in CIA might be considered culpable for the death of those 17 sailors because they were not forthcoming before the attacks about their knowledge about two men in the United States who could be connected to the formational meeting for the USS Cole attack. And it's a really interesting cat and mouse story because it seems that the CIA finds themselves in a position where, as the summer, the famous summer of warning, they called it after the fact, like the summer before 9/11, like when George Tenet's hair is on fire at CIA, there's getting so many rumblings about something big coming on the Al-Qaeda front. It seems that they want to be able to come clean, but their asses are really on the line if they do. So they got to find a way to get the FBI to stumble on these guys on their own. So what ends up happening is they assign this FBI analyst who happens to be stationed over at the CIA to look into the old cable traffic at CIA. And this cable traffic, from the time these guys arrived in the United States, made clear that a couple heavy-hitting Al-Qaeda operators had arrived. So they're like sort of spoon-feeding her these cables, just trying to get her to like notice it. And then when she does, this is a really interesting thing, when she does in late August, weeks before 9/11, she immediately heads down the hall to her CIA counterparts and says, oh, we got to start a hunt for these guys right away. They immediately call the FBI's New York office, as they should have done a year and a half prior. And a belated hunt for the guys begins, but it turns out there was too little time and they aren't able to find them in time.
I think it probably gets a little more weedy than that, because there were multiple points at which the CIA could have been forthcoming with that information, because Agent Ali Soufan requested it three times. There was a meeting that was held in June of 2001. It was supposed to be an information sharing meeting between the FBI and the CIA, and the CIA people start showing some photographs to the FBI people saying, hey, do you know who these people are in these photographs? And when they say, no, who are they? They go, yeah, we can't tell you. And it seemed to be a meeting to really to find out if they, how far on the trail of this they were. So there were these points where that information could have been shared again and again, all the way up until that point in August, there were several opportunities for them to do it that they didn't take. I don't personally feel that the entire Alex Station office there was looking for that opportunity to make the information pass and make it look sort of organic. I think there's probably a little bit of conflict within the office there and the people who knew what was going on. Again, if you go through the email traffic and stuff between them, it does look like one particular guy is nudging everyone like, hey, maybe we should make this a thing. Maybe we should let the FBI know about this now.
There's literally an email at some point, I think in July, where he says, may we pass this info to the FBI via official cable now? And that email has no record of a reply.
This is the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with Chase Palmieri. We're speaking with authors Ray Nowosielski and John Duffy. Their book is The Watchdogs Didn't Bark. We will return after this musical break. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with co-host Chase Palmieri. On today's program, we're talking to the authors of a recent book that came out last year on Skyhorse and Hot Books with David Talbot doing the foreword. That was one of Talbot's series at Skyhorse. This book is titled The Watchdogs Didn't Bark, The CIA, NSA, and the Crimes of the War on Terror. We are speaking today with authors John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski. One of you want to pick up that baton?
My final point was I didn't think that there was like a monolithic understanding amongst the handful of people at ALEC and Counterterror who were aware of this. I think there was probably some discord amongst them about what to do with it that late in the game. And I think some other zealot type staff was probably like, no, don't share it. While some of the other ones were like, we have to. And I think there might have been a little conflict there. But we could definitely say that by September 4th, a week before 9/11, Richard Clark had been like pounding the hallways at the White House trying to have a meeting with the new George W. Bush administration and his national security staff to talk about the threat of al-Qaeda and terrorism. And he finally gets this meeting. It's a principal's meeting, September 4th, a week before the attacks. George Tenet sitting in the room, and he doesn't mention any of this, and he was well aware of it by that time. So even up to that last week before 9/11, there was a perfect opportunity for someone from CIA at a high level to share this information about the presence of these hijackers in the country, and he just sat there quietly and didn't say anything.
There's some things that you are talking about, and you're using acronyms. You're not always spelling some things out. Like, for example, when you say Alec, your book has so many different moving parts and characters and people. And this is, again, one of the good things about the book that I want to make sure that listeners know. And also, by the way, you can find out more at watchdogsbark.com, and you can learn more about the book there. But not only do you have the usual dedication and, you know, this kind of business in the book, but you have a whole note on sources. You have an entire list of principal characters and who they are so that people, when they begin reading this, they can really wrap their heads around. I mean, again, you guys have been researching this and dealing with this topic for years. So take a second and just talk about a couple of those things, like when the CIA is trying to flip somebody for what purpose, and you know what were a couple of these other organizations?
This was our education on the CIA. We weren't exactly CIA aficionados until we started looking at the story, and we were forced to try to understand what they do. Most of us have a very cursory idea. I think if you ask most Americans what the CIA does, they just know they do some dark stuff that needs to be done, supposedly, right? And maybe it's a little James Bondy, and that's about as far as it goes. But pretty much every major city in the country, there's a secret CIA station somewhere. And there may be up to a dozen or roughly, you know, that number of people there. And those people are looking to recruit assets. So if you're at the station in Moscow, you're hopefully trying to find a way to, quote unquote, flip somebody that's close with Putin, right? Because and chances are you're not just going to come up and say, hey, we're with the American government. It'd be really great if you fed us some information. Payoffs are involved. There are various ways to grease the wheels. The whole point there is that then those stations feed this information back to the people who analyze it. And the people we're talking about are mostly these analysts that work safely, by and large, from headquarters just outside D.C. in Langley, Virginia, in this massive compound. And the number of employees that work for CIA is quite incredible. The point being is at some point they created this station, again, safely there at Langley headquarters, that was going to be treated like a virtual overseas station. And instead of being dedicated to Moscow or Rome or somewhere, it would be dedicated to this burgeoning group called Al-Qaeda and its leader, Osama bin Laden. And so it wasn't a very big office, and they weren't really taken seriously by most of the rest of CIA. Initially, they were off in another building outside the CIA headquarters. And then as they got to be a little more important, eventually they got moved down into the whole like counter-terror section underneath the basement. And the point is there are about 50 of them. And their job was solely to know the players inside Al-Qaeda and theoretically to try to do what these foreign stations do, which is get sources on the inside, people that are feeding you information. People, you know, Al-Qaeda thinks that this is their guy, but really it's the CIA's guy. And so that's the theory that Clark laid out to us, is that they were desperate. They had not gotten sources inside Al-Qaeda. There were more and more attacks that were happening that Al-Qaeda had been responsible for over the course of the 1990s. And so when these two guys arrive in the U.S. after attending like a major Al-Qaeda meeting that had been surveilled by CIA, CIA saw their opportunity. They were going to be damned if they handed it over to John O'Neill, who they hated in the FBI. And they proceeded with an ill-advised and illegal operation to either surveil or flip these guys. And when it blew up in their faces, so to speak, on 9/11, they certainly were not going to come clean about it, because it would have, in the words of one interviewee that we talked to, meant the end of CIA had that come out at that time.
So now that our listeners have all of that context, I'm wondering, during your digging through all of this, I have two questions. The first is, who do you think is the most accountable, if you can name names, for this handoff not taking place and essentially the attack being able to take place? And then also, has the relationship between the CIA handing off domestic information to the FBI, has that been fixed, or is that same process still broken to this day?
On the note of naming names, that's actually one thing we really like to do. To specifically say who's the most responsible, I mean, I guess you'd probably have to lay that at George Tenet's door, just because he was the director and he was in the know on this. And if what Clark assumes is true, then it was all done with his blessing. So George Tenet, definitely, and he perjured himself in front of the 9/11 commission after the fact, so he should be convicted for that. But then I would imagine we'd be wanting to lay guilt with everyone at Alex Station who was involved with it, who had full range of opportunity, according to Clark, to alert the White House counterterror team, and who didn't, and who had full range of opportunity to alert the FBI and didn't. I mean, you had people who, I won't bury people in jargon here. There is a program to send agents from one agency to another to facilitate information sharing. There were several people from FBI counterterror who were put in that role at the CIA's Alex Station. So there were about four FBI people in the room there who were aware when this important visa information and travel information was coming in. And they did try, in fact, to pass it over to their compatriots at the New York FBI and were told not to. Now, one of the people who was cited in that telling them not to is a gentleman named Tom Wilshire, but he didn't directly tell them not to. That was what was conveyed. He was the deputy director at the time. It was conveyed to them in like an internal email to hold off on passing that information as per the deputy director. So that would have been Tom Wilshire. There was a woman who worked there by the name of Alfreda Bukowski, who went on to do a bunch of other horrible stuff like relating to torture, which is in the book. She lied about it to the investigations after the fact, claiming that she had personally walked this information down to an FBI office, which the investigators later found to be completely false. So she lied about that. Those would be some of the names you could throw out there right now. And the second part of that question was...
It's about the handoff, the process.
So the 9/11 Commission was a bit of a mixed bag. In terms of getting to the truth on this particular issue, I'd say it was the weakest among the investigations in terms of moving forward some additional information that helped us put this all together. But the commission was pretty decent at realizing that a main theme of 9/11 was a failure of passage of information. So they put into place various protocols, and I know FBI agents and CIA agents are fairly aware of this story, although they may not all be aware of the possibility of this operation underneath this story. So I think, yes, things most likely have improved on that front. But in my opinion, and this was the opinion of the 9/11 widows that fought for the commission that so inspired us to make our first film and kind of set us on the track towards writing this book. The Press for Truth was the name of that documentary. For them, it was always about accountability. And they felt like it was such a simple thing. Like, if you're running a company and somebody fails miserably at their job, and then you just leave them in that position, it's probably only going to get worse. The people that they bring in and train, as time goes on, the longer you leave bad actors in their positions, once they've proven to be failures, things just metastasize. So I think we're probably far less safe than even at the time of 9/11, because the people that were inside Alex Station didn't get held accountable. Instead, they got promoted. They all got their own sets of staffs. And the people that came out of Alex Station ended up taking over CIA within the last 5 to 10 years. Alfreda Bukowski, that was mentioned by John, still works there. As far as we are aware, she goes in every day to Langley and continues to play a high-level role in the War on Terror, which doesn't make me feel great. Gina Haspel was an ally of hers. One of the people that got brought in by this Alex Station team was this guy that was described to us as a psychopath named Jose Rodriguez, who was in charge of the torture program. And Gina Haspel was essentially his chief of staff, who was part of destroying torture tapes after the fact and so on and so forth. So it depends on how you look at the lessons of this story. But if the chief lesson is that we need accountability, we need a clean house, that we need to realize when we've done wrong and address it, then not doing that, I think we make the case in our book, has spread throughout not only the CIA, but has gone on to sort of spread through the U.S. government.
And as we saw lot after 9/11, a lot of the people who were involved in this actually end up getting promoted, not demoted or not punished, nothing negative happening. Just real quick before we need to take another break, you both keep mentioning Alex Station. Could you tell our listeners what that means specifically?
Yeah, Alex Station was, like Ray said, it was a virtual station that existed in Langley, so it wasn't overseas, it was a CIA station. Staffed with analysts, and it was basically dedicated to bin Laden and Al-Qaeda. So that was their entire focus.
We're going to take another break here and come back and continue our conversation. I want to go back and talk a little bit more about some of these other forewarnings and maybe Kofor Black and a few other things. We're speaking with the authors of The Watchdogs Didn't Bark. This is a book that came out last summer. The CIA, NSA, and the Crimes of the War on Terror. The authors are John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski, with a foreword by David Talbot. Again, this was on Skyhorse Books and part of the Hot Books series. You can learn more at watchdogsbark.com. I'm Mickey Huff with Chase Palmieri. You're listening to the Project Censored Show. After this musical break, we'll continue our conversation on The Watchdogs Didn't Bark. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with Chase Palmieri. On today's program, we're speaking to the authors of The Watchdogs Didn't Bark. You can learn more at watchdogsbark.com. The subtitle of the book, The CIA, NSA, and the Crimes of the War on Terror. John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski are the authors of this important book. Ray Nowosielski is a documentary filmmaker and writer who's reported for Salon and Truthout and contributed to investigations by The Daily Beast and Gawker. He's also worked with Discovery, History Channel, Investigation Discovery, Netflix, and Vice. John Duffy is a writer and activist. He wrote and produced the critically acclaimed documentary Press for Truth, which we've mentioned here previously on the program, and the investigative true crime podcast Who is Rich Blee? Duffy's worked extensively in the environmental movement to fight tar sands extraction, fracking, and logging on public lands, and writes anonymous essays critiquing the contradictions of big systems and their fallout on ecology and society. We'll be talking a little bit about that as we wrap up this interview today. But let's get back to our authors, Ray Nowosielski and John Duffy. So we've been talking about some of these forewarnings, messages that don't get passed along. And of course, in the Project Censored 40th anniversary book, story number 11 was one of the stories that we highlighted that year. And it was a story by Chris Whipple, the executive producer and writer of The Spymaster, CIA and the Crosshairs. And he had this very interesting series of events that he lays out here. Of course, a lot of people know about the CIA's presidential daily briefing, Condoleezza Rice, August 6, 2001, Al-Qaeda determined to strike in the U.S., where she apparently lied under oath to the 9/11 Commission about not having any idea that planes could be used as weapons and so forth. It's just it was a preposterous performance by Rice at the time. But they do also focus in on a couple of other characters. And Ray and John, I'd like you to talk a little bit more about some of what was going on in the May before summer of 2001, particularly around people like Rich Blee and Kofor Black. Ray or John?
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned Rich Blee. I forgot to throw his name out there when we were throwing names out there. So Rich Blee had been head of Alex Station. He became head of Alex Station after a man named Mike Scheuer was kind of tossed out of it. Mike Scheuer was basically the founder of Alex Station there at CIA, and he's a very interesting personality, which clashed with a lot of people. And after a particular event with a fight, he was pushed out, and we detail that in the book. But Richard Blee was the person who followed him as the director of Alex Station. And when we made our podcast, Who is Rich Blee?, our intent was we looked at it like, okay, well, there was a bin Laden unit that was supposed to stop bin Laden from attacking the U.S., and bin Laden attacked the U.S., so clearly the bin Laden unit failed, so the head of the bin Laden unit should bear some responsibility for that. But it was a name that wasn't really out there that, you know, very few people knew, so that's why we made that particular podcast, so people could become aware that he was the director for a large period of time. He accompanied George Tenet and Kofor Black to a variety of briefings. He accompanied George Tenet to a briefing in July of 2001, which was a briefing to Condoleezza Rice and Richard Clark. Basically, had said, something big is coming. It's coming soon, and I have to warn the White House staff. And he just demanded this meeting with Condoleezza Rice. And so they get there, they sit down, and he's laying out his case for why something needs to be done about Al-Qaeda, and he never once mentions Khalid al-Midar and Nawaf al-Hazmi being in the country or the fact that the CIA is aware that these guys have come to the country. So Richard Clark would later tell us, he would say, if you're trying to make your best case for action, why do you tell us everything except this? Like, why do you leave out this piece of information?
Yeah, well, going back from Politico, going back into May of 2001, there's a quote here from the Politico article. Tenet vividly recalls the White House meeting with Rice and her team. George W. Bush was on a trip to Boston. Rich Blee started by saying, quote, there will be significant terrorist attacks against the United States in the coming weeks or months. The attacks will be spectacular. They will be multiple. Al-Qaeda's intention is the destruction of the United States, end quote. That's pretty riveting information, and of course, Chris Whipple had asked Kofor Black what happened with that warning and then claimed that he responded in bemusement by saying, yeah, what did happen? And Black purportedly said, quote, to me, it remains incomprehensible still. I mean, how is it that you could warn senior people so many times and nothing actually happened? it's kind of like the Twilight Zone. Ray, what are your thoughts about some of that material?
So it's like there's two categories here. And assuming the best intentions of George W. Bush and his administration, that they were simply just jaw-droppingly inept and not interested in this Al-Qaeda issue, or possibly corrupt in that because of their ties to the Saudis, they didn't want to look that period, but that they didn't know what was going to happen, right? There's such a case to be made, and we started making it in our movie Press for Truth based on the work that had been compiled by the Jersey Widows. They started out in the first weeks after 9/11 with these straight up, there were no warnings. We found clip after clip of there were no warnings, nothing with planes, no nothing with New York.
They weren't mistakes. They were flat out lies.
After the fact, the question of a cover-up is obvious. What I'm getting at is there's the story of all this information that was passed to the White House by CIA. And then there's the story of this one little piece of information, which is that Mihdhar and Hazmi were in the country, that wasn't passed to the White House. And it's interesting because one ends up protecting the other. Because, you know, we talked with Colonel Larry Wilkerson, who was the chief of staff to the Secretary of State Colin Powell at the time. And he told us he was fairly certain for the first couple weeks after 9/11 that Bush and Cheney were, quote unquote, scared shitless, that they were going to get impeached, that it was going to become discovered how badly they had messed this up, given the number of warnings. So it was not in their interest to make the CIA be held to account or to expose the CIA for what it had failed to provide the White House about these two future hijackers. So it became this kind of interesting quid pro quo where the CIA was looking for more power, more money. Give us the job. We'll go after Al-Qaeda. We'll run your war on terror. And because of the failure on both sides, the failure of the White House to recognize all these warnings that had come in and do anything about them, and the failure of the CIA to pass the most important and actionable warning, everybody ended up protecting each other afterwards. There's no other word for it. It was a cover-up.
And so let's assume that the CIA had, in fact, passed along the information for a second, that the Al-Qaeda operatives Mihdhar and Hazmi were in the United States. What would have happened? Would the FBI have gone and picked them up? Would that have actually thwarted the attack in any way? What do you think would have actually played out had the information been relayed?
By and large, I would imagine that what would have most likely happened, and again, it would depend on when this information got passed.
Right.
If you're talking sort of right away when it should have been, I do imagine that had it been passed along to the counterterror office at the New York FBI, yeah, they would have called the San Diego office and they would have had some people go down to the apartments in San Diego where they were living and probably arrest them. They were known Al-Qaeda actors. They had been involved in fighting in Chechnya. They had just left this planning session in Kuala Lumpur. And the surveillance of that session had been passed to the highest levels of the White House and the FBI. I mean, people were aware these Al-Qaeda guys were getting together to plan things, and they were up to no good. Should two of those guys fly to Los Angeles and move to San Diego, I'm sure if the FBI counterterror squads on the ground knew they were there, yeah, they would have gone and arrested them. And would that have prevented the attack? Most likely. They were connected to all the other guys at some level. Again, this is speculative. When are they here? When's this arrest happening? Would they have watched them for a month or two and then gone and got them? No one can really know. But the fact is they were connected to all the other eventual hijackers who would arrive. And the plot could have very well been wrapped up. I don't think it's speculative to say that that is a key, that the plot very much could have and would likely have been wrapped up.
Ray?
I think about quotes from two gentlemen we interviewed, Richard Clark, the former top man for counterterror in the U.S. government and the White House, and Jack Clunin, who was the FBI counterterror person who actually got the call when the search for the two future hijackers began and was unsuccessful a couple weeks before the attacks. And those quotes are, you know, Richard Clark said to us, if he had told us, meaning George Tenet, the head of the CIA, even as late as September 4th, we would have found Mihdhar and Hazmi. There's no doubt in my mind, he says. They were listed in the Yellow Pages under their own names. They were staying at the Charles Hotel in Harvard Square, for heaven's sake. If we had put out a request on the AP wire, they would have been arrested within 24 hours. We would have found those, he said, which was quite memorable. And then Jack Clunin says, Now, there are some, and I'm paraphrasing here because I don't have his quote in front of me, but there are some who would say, well, what good does that do? Now you're only into one part of the plot. You've got a couple of the hijackers. He says, he calls baloney on that. And he says, because if you started surveilling those guys, especially if they've been told early on enough, where do they go? They go and they meet with Muhammad Atta, the lead hijacker. They go and meet with all the hijackers at some point. They all purchase plane tickets for the same date. So you could see all the other guys with Saudi names that were all flying out of the same airlines on the same date. So he says, we absolutely would have wrapped it up. And he further says, if you look at this, this was not a systems failure. This was just a handful of people, maybe a dozen at CIA, that could have changed this equation. And he says, I don't know how they sleep at night. I really don't. And I don't either.
That's the voice of co-author Ray Nowosielski. And we're speaking with him and John Duffy. They are authors of a book that came out last summer on Skyhorse Hot Books, The Watchdogs Didn't Bark. We are going to conclude our conversation on this subject after our final musical break. Please stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with Chase Palmieri. We're talking to the authors of a book that came out last summer around the events of 9/11, The Watchdogs Didn't Bark, The CIA, NSA, and the Crimes of the War on Terror, by John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski. We are speaking with them now. The book had a foreword by David Talbot. You can learn more at the website for the book, which is watchdogsbark.com. I wanted to, this last segment that we have, the little time we have left, one of the things I wanted to bring out is I want to conclude with a little bit on systems theory issues, because you actually start the book out that way. Let's finish with that idea. Before that, I want to mention something else, because you had interviewed so many people. You write in the beginning of the book, a few individuals, in particular, Richard Clark, Thomas Drake, but we've talked about Clark, that's counterterrorism, Thomas Drake, the NSA whistleblower, John Kuryakow, CIA whistleblower, and Mark Rossini, that's FBI whistleblower, basically. They provided a disproportionate number of the statements that you have in the book that you say here. But you conclude that section by saying the readers must make their own judgments as to the character and motives of these individuals. But if you believe these men in particular, then most everything in this book happened as described. And interestingly enough, John and Ray, all four of these people have been maligned and attacked viciously in public by government sources and the media. Isn't that right?
Prosecuted and persecuted. Kiriakou goes to jail. Thomas Drake, he's a really interesting guy. He's like a Boy Scout. I mean, he just really believes in truth, justice, and the American way, and he was going to be damned if he pled guilty to charges of espionage or other things for talking to reporters about stories like this, and he ended up beating it. A rare case. Mark had to plead guilty to another charge. There are stories that we tell in the book about each of them, but essentially they seemed to all be targeted because they were all too willing to tell parts of this story.
Even with an hour, we can't possibly get into all of the details, minutiae of the book. You've already mentioned Clark. We've talked about Kuryakou a little bit. Very briefly, could you explain to our listeners the significance in your story of Thomas Drake and Mark Rossini?
As briefly as I can, Thomas Drake worked for the NSA. His first day was basically 9/11. He'd been working for them previously as a contractor, but his first day as like a full-on employee was that day. He ends up describing watching the NSA basically treat 9/11 as if it was a gift, as if they were going to get tons and tons of money and power from 9/11. But then as he went around and spoke with the rank-and-file employees, he realized that a lot of them, the ones who were involved in monitoring particular Al-Qaeda assets, were basically losing their minds because they knew something was coming and they weren't allowed to get that information out to anyone who could do anything about it. So Thomas Drake tells us about that. amongst other things. And then the other person you wanted me to comment on, Mark Rossini worked at the New York office of the FBI counterterror under John O'Neill. He was one of the people who was tasked with being swapped over to the CIA as part of that information sharing program. So he was put in Alex Station, and he was handpicked by John O'Neill to be there. John O'Neill wanted Mark to be his eyes and ears inside CIA to know what was going on over there with their hunt for bin Laden and the hunt of Al-Qaeda. And Mark Rossini was there when critical information was coming in about Al-Qaeda hijackers coming to the country after they left the terror summit. And he watched as his fellow FBI employee tried to send that information off back to New York and was told not to. He even tried to back his buddy up. There was a man named Doug Miller, and he tried to back Doug Miller up, going to other CIA staff saying, like, hey, you know, why isn't this cable moving? Why can't we get this information out? And he was told this is not a matter for the FBI. And Mark, basically, when 9/11 happened and he lost John O'Neill, his mentor, and he lost friends, he basically said, the rules. I played by the rules and look what happened. And so now I'm gonna talk to whoever I need to talk to get the truth out. So he was a whistleblower there.
So just to back that up for a second, you mentioned how some members at the NSA were aware that the attack was coming, or that these individuals or something about the situation was going to occur. Can you explain maybe what they knew at that time before the attack and how they knew it? So did they come across this information on their own, or was the information shared with from the CIA to the NSA?
That's one of the pieces we essentially revealed for the first time in this book. I'm proud of the fact that the book pulls together a lot of stuff that you probably would have to search pretty hard to find, and a lot of stuff that hasn't come out before, and puts it all in one place. But this was one that we unearthed, in large part from Thomas Drake, but from others as well and from documents. And the story there, in a nutshell, is so obvious when you think about it. What it was since 1996, one of the main Al-Qaeda telephone hubs, the one used for the planning of the 98 embassy bombings, the one used for the Cole bombing in 2000, and presumably for 9/11, that house was owned by one of the lead hijackers, Khalid Al-Madar's father-in-law, and it had been surveilled since 1996 by both the NSA and, to a lesser limited degree, by the CIA. And so when Midhar, the future hijacker, arrives in San Diego and is there for a period of months afterwards, of course he wants to call. He wants to check in on his wife, who's back at the house with his father-in-law. Perhaps he wants to make some calls regarding this operation that he's undertaking to the primary communications hub. So every time he calls this hub, the NSA analysts who are in charge of Al-Qaeda, and it was an even smaller office than CIA's Alex Station, it's less than a dozen people. But there was a person, we call her Becky in the book, who was in charge of monitoring that hub. And whenever there would be a call from the United States to that hub, she'd get a little ping. Now, because of privacy protections regarding spying domestically on the United States, they couldn't necessarily listen in on the calls that were happening. But that's not really as important as the fact that you've got somebody calling the primary Al-Qaeda telephone hub from San Diego and doing it repeatedly. So what we were told was they went and they made a request that the FISA court be asked if they can start putting them on copy, meaning can we start recording these calls, translating these calls. And what we're told happened was it went to the quote-unquote chop chain, which is this group within NSA that decides whether such a request can be made. And that's the top executives there, people like Maureen Baginski, Chris Inglis, General Michael Hayden, who was the head of NSA, his top staff. And supposedly, they made the decision not to go to the FISA court. It's not clear if they did or they didn't, but what we know is that the people who were working the Al-Qaeda issue as analysts at a lower level of NSA were under the impression that they had never gotten that FISA warrant. They themselves never saw any translations or calls from that house, but we're well aware that Al-Qaeda people were in the U.S.
We only have a few minutes remaining, and I want to remind listeners again that we're speaking with authors and filmmakers. The book is titled The Watchdogs Didn't Bark, The CIA, NSA, and the Crimes of the War on Terror by John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski, who are our guests today. You both write in the preface, and again, we could have started with this, but I thought it was a nice wrapping point at the end here. And you've certainly given our listeners a lot more to think about again and maybe even revisit. A lot of people who've been familiar with the 9/11 story maybe didn't put all these dots together or may learn more. You can learn more at the website watchdogsbark.com. But you also write about systems theory, and you write here in the preface, the purpose of a system is what it does. This is something that you have some background in. The purpose of a system is what it does. And you write, Stafford Beer coined this phrase to be used by systems theorists as a reminder to see beyond the intentions of those who design and operate a particular system, and instead to gain greater insight by observing total system behavior. And again, you say a simpler way of saying this is, it's not a bug, it's a feature. Ray and John, in the last few minutes, could you address how you use this overarching idea as a point of analysis in your book?
I guess I was really wanting something like that at the outset of the book, because I think there's a common misunderstanding of what the CIA or the NSA are there to do. I think the common man on the street might just think like, oh, they're there to protect us. But if you sit and watch what they have done in the decades of their existence, they are used typically to foment war, and most of these wars are for Western capitalist control over trade routes or resources around the world, whatever it is. And then beyond that, that power protects power, and that we can't just think they know the machine. They are good at getting away with their crimes, and to think that, oh, we'll just get the Justice Department on it and it will all be okay. Like, they know the angles. They know how to hide their people. They know how to avoid accountability. And we need to think not like, oh, these guys are off and they're doing things that are contrary to the mission. It's like, when you look at what they've done for decades upon decades, that's the mission.
Ray?
I would just add, because I would hate to go on Project Censored and not bring up what I think is the most censored part of the story, which is a woman named Alfreda Bukowski. Alfreda Bukowski was somebody we discovered ourselves in 2011. The name had never before been out there until it dropped on our website. Going forward with that name so freaked out the CIA that they took the unprecedented move of threatening us, probably just bluffing us, but nonetheless, putting out there that they might prosecute us under the Intelligence Identities Protection Act if we move forward with the story, which, had they done that, would have been a major expansion from going after people who work for the government who have classified, clearances, to going after journalists who reveal the classified information. The point being, Alfreda, what we figured out was between her first alleged act of criminality, which theoretically took place in December of 2000 when she withheld information from FBI investigators who were specifically requesting it from her, to when her name came out on our website and then came out in a story on Gawker and then shortly thereafter on Salon. It was 11 years, 10 months. 11 years and 10 months in which her name was mentioned in the CIA accountability report saying that she had blame for 9/11, a period in which the Associated Press did a story about somebody they simply referred to by her middle name, Francis, so no one could know who it was, saying that she had renditioned an innocent man, a German, based on a hunch. Her name mentioned in torture reports, but always redacted. Jane Mayer mentioning that she took a trip to Poland to help with torture for fun when she wasn't assigned and got a mild reprimand, but only called her the redhead. And so not naming her, it was certainly a form of censorship over the course of that 11 years, 10 months. The thing that really astounds me is that even after the name dropped and we told people what she had done and the cat was out of the bag, yes, Gawker, yes, Salon, but never the New York Times, never CNN to this day, never MSNBC, never Fox News. Washington Post mentioned her once, 8 paragraphs down in a story about her CIA lawyer without any context about her. We thought running this book would finally force her to be addressed in the major media. And we have not gotten any mainstream reviews. And still to this day, I would say no mainstream media have ever covered the amazing story of Alfreda Bukowski.
let's just conclude on the systems idea here that John Duffy was just saying, Ray Nowosielski. The corporate media is not in the business of necessarily telling the people what's actually going on. They're in the business of protecting their own interests in the military-industrial complex. So as you write in the preface, this also maybe applies to the corporate media and also state media, that they don't have an interest in helping you catapult or platform your story because they've spent a lot of time covering it up.
Exactly.
Well, John Duffy and Ray Nowosielski, your book is called The Watchdogs Didn't Bark, the CIA, NSA, and the Crimes of the War on Terror. To learn more, go to watchdogsbark.com. And we certainly hope that on the Project Censored show, we will help get the word out about your book and your research. And who knows, maybe we'll be able to crack through what seems oft like the impenetrable walls of the corporate top-down managed news propaganda systems that dominate our information ecosystems. John and Ray, thanks so much for joining us today on the Project Censored show.
Thanks for
having me. Thanks for what you do, Mickey.
Supporting human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians, cause they own by special interest groups that fund their campaign. That's why you hear the same old things they claim, but change never came. It's a dirty game maintained by rain for capital gain, but my people getting tired of the pain and the...
You've been listening to the Project Censored show, established in 2010 by Mickey Huff and Peter Phillips. Mickey Huff is executive producer and host of the program with myself, Chase Palmieri. Anthony Fest is our senior producer, and Dennis Murphy is our associate producer. The Project Censored show airs on over 50 stations around the United States from Maui to New York. To learn more about our work or to find any of our previous archived programs, go to projectcensored.org. Please follow and like us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and be sure to subscribe to the Project Censored show on YouTube and your cell phone's podcast app. Feel free to share your feedback about our work, and last but not least, thanks to all of you, our listeners, for tuning in. We'll see you next time. Political ties, habitualized alibis, disguise under the guise of democracy, politics of the apocalypse. Got the skies looking ominous. So the ocean burned bright with waves full of poison. Genocide, wars, far for little poison. The weapons manufactured paid for by attacks upon the prisons and the levees and the mines collapsing. All the prisons, build the capacity, citizens. And the ties for the master thief, combine and conquer, steal a masterpiece. Open your eyes and realize what's happening. Time's running out to reach all potential fame. At the table, then you're probably on the menu. We got that love, we flipped up from the